Thank you. This morning I'm going to be reading from Ephesians chapter 3. The sermon is on verse 1 through 13. For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles, surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. That is, the mystery made known to me by revelation, as I have already written briefly. In reading this, then, you will be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to people in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. This mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, and sharers together in the promise in Christ Jesus. I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God, who created all things. His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. In him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are your glory. It's from Ephesians chapter 3. Sorry, maybe I should have had this ready before I got up here.
Actually, you can take the red binder off there.
I can take the red binder off? Okay, all right, thank you. I'll just close it. That's fine. Okay. Sorry about the awkward start. I always tell my pastor back home, I gotta work on my transitions. Here we go. There's evidence of that. I gotta work on my transitions. All right, so we're just gonna go through, start with verse 1 here, chapter 3, verse 1. For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. So we can see who's writing here. This letter, Ephesians, one of the letters written by Paul. And I know we're kind of jumping right into the middle of the letter, but at least he introduces himself again, right? And you can see, actually, that he's in prison. Well, he's writing this letter. And why is he in prison? Well, he says, for the sake of you Gentiles. And that might seem strange to you, because you might think, well, why? How does Paul being in prison help me? Like, Anna, did you put him in jail? No? Jim, like, do you call the police up and say, you gotta go arrest this Paul guy, like, because it's really gonna help me out? And you might think, well, that's kind of strange. How does it help? And so, he's gonna actually answer that in the next part of this, but for now, we're just gonna have to leave this question to the side. Can we just go back to the verse just one more time there, Mark? Okay. And if you look at this, you'll see there's no verb in this sentence. Remember, a sentence needs to have a subject, an object, and a verb. But he just says, I, Paul. So it's like if I start a sentence, I say, I. Well, where's the rest of the sentence? Well, actually, that doesn't come way down until verse 14. He finishes the sentence way, way down there. But he's going to stop and explain what he means, that I'm a prisoner of Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles. So we're going to move on to verse 2 and 3. Surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. That is the mystery made known to me by revelation, as I have already written briefly. So God gave Paul many gifts. He gave him the gift of preaching. He gave him the gift of tongues, of healing, of prophecy. And that was all to spread the gospel message. But he also gave him a particular insight, a mystery made known to him by revelation. And that's actually why we need the whole Bible. Right? We have this Old Testament, and we have the books of Moses, and Moses was great, but not everything was revealed to Moses. Or not everything was revealed to Isaiah. Not everything was revealed to Paul. And that's why we actually have 66 books in here. Because they all have a little slice of revelation gifted to them by God. And that together it makes up the whole scripture. And this is Paul's special gift, this mystery made known to me by revelation. The church had other leaders, right? There was already 12 apostles. There was 7 deacons who would go waiting on tables and helping the poor. And there was Peter, John, and James. They were like the leaders in the church, right? Kind of the driving force behind a lot of things. But Paul had this one piece of insight, one thing that he had nobody else had. And we're going to see that moving on in verse 4 and 5. In reading this, then, you will be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to people in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. So he says, you will be able to understand my insight into the mystery. And this is kind of a strange word. Mystery is the right way to translate it, but he uses it in a kind of a different sense than we use it. So let's say you go home and you check your mailbox. I don't know why you do it on a Sunday, but let's just say you open your mailbox and there's $100 sitting there. And you say, wow, somebody gave me $100. I don't know who it is. What a mystery. Right? Because we call a mystery something that is not revealed. But actually, Paul says, it's not something that you can understand. He says, you will be able to understand. And it's not something that is unrevealed because it's been revealed to Paul. So he uses mystery in a different sense. It's something that used to be concealed, but now is revealed. Everyone with me so far? Okay, so it's just kind of a different, it still means mystery. At one point it was mysterious, but now we know. After Jesus, we actually know what's going on. And in fact, in verse 6, he's going to tell us the mystery. So if you thought this was like a good mystery novel, I'm sorry, it's really not. He's getting right to the whodunit here. This mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, sharers together in the promise in Christ Jesus. And see, the mystery is revealed. So this is Paul's one insight. This one thing that he has that the other apostles, they don't really emphasize anymore. It's the good news that God loves the whole world. And that he sent his son to die for everyone. That everyone can be born again. Like I said in my testimony earlier, it doesn't matter how far down you are. You know, when you leave this church today, everybody you look at, if you look them in the eyes, you're going to see somebody who's made in the image of God. Someone who Jesus died for, someone who Jesus loves. And maybe they're struggling with opioid addictions, or whatever demons are chasing them now. But God still loves that person. And that person still needs the gospel. And he also preached a message that God has been faithful to his promises. Because God promised in the Old Testament, he promised, I will bless my people, I will protect my people, I will preserve my people. But what was surprising, and what Paul brought, was actually that his people is not just one ethnicity. It's actually a great multitude, made up of many tribes, every language, every nation can be part of the people of God, who God will bless and protect and preserve. And this message was shocking. And this is actually why Paul ended up in prison. Because, to the Jews, this was a shocking message. Because the promises to Abraham, the promises to Isaac, the promises to Jacob, they're not just to the Israelites. They're to everybody. And that made some Jews very angry. What do you mean we're not God's special people? And Paul never said that they're not God's special people. He's just saying that actually that God's special people can be made up from every nation. But that made people angry. Can you imagine being told your whole life, you're my favorite son? And then all of a sudden, actually, you're my favorite son over there too. Okay, Rory, you're God's favorite son as well. All right? And actually everybody can be part of, through adoption, we can all be part of God's family. And so that stirred up people. But he made the Gentiles angry, too. It wasn't just the Jews he was making angry. He made the non-Jews, sorry, I should clarify, Gentiles, just a word that means not Jewish. So everybody here, unless you're Jewish, you're also a Gentile. It's not an insult, okay? It's just that's just how it is. But he made the Gentiles angry, too, because he told them, you can't actually worship idols. And that at the time, people made statues, they carved them out of wood, they carved them out of metal, out of stone, and they would bow down and worship. And they still do that in many parts of the world, right? You know, they'll light a candle in front of their shrine, or, you know, put incense on it. And he said, well, actually, you can't do that. And these people, when they heard this message, some of them got very angry, because maybe they made money carving, they were really good at carving. So now there goes my livelihood. Or maybe they had spent their whole life offering things to this useless piece of wood. And now they realize, hey, I've been on the wrong path my whole life. And some people, they'd be glad to know. But some people come kicking and screaming from it. So everywhere Paul went, he was angering the Jews because he said, well, actually, all these people over here used to worship idols. They can be part of God's people too. But he angered the people who worship idols because he showed them actually the God of Israel is the God of the whole world. He's the one who created the world, and he is the only true God. So everywhere he went, he made people angry. And that's why he went to prison. So now we can go back to that question from earlier. How does Paul being in prison help the Gentiles? Well, the reason he was arrested was because he shared this gospel that Jesus died for you, that God wants to be with you forever in eternity. That the Lord of all creation wants to come down and have a meal with you. And that message saved people. And that's why he says it's helping the Gentiles. All right, moving on through verses 7 to 9. Now this section, they're not all going to fit on one slide, so I just kind of had to make it so you can still read it. But if you open it to your Bible, you can follow along. He says, I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me, through the working of his power. Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given me, to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ, and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God, who created all things. So, I've had this sermon in my mind for several months now. I wanted to start it right here at verse 7. But after praying, God's revealed to me that, we gotta include some of the context. So we have our foundation of the gospel. Now we're going to move on to the meat of the sermon. So Paul here is talking about his own experience. Because God gave Paul this revelation. He revealed to him that, hey, the people of God is not just the Jews anymore. Everyone can be the people of God. But he also gave him the gift of preaching to share that message. It wasn't enough for Paul to know all this stuff. He had to share it too. Right? It wasn't just revealed. He had to preach it. And Paul calls that a grace in verse 7, to serve the gospel, to make plain to everyone the mystery and the boundless riches of Christ. And when I read this, I identify with Paul. I shared my testimony earlier, why I went to school. It was so I could know more stuff. And God made it clear to me, it's not good enough to know all this stuff. That's not what's going to help people. You have to share it. It's not good enough to just bottle it all up inside you. You have to share your testimony for it to help someone, right? And that's what happened with Paul. Now, I can't fully identify with him. I'm not an apostle, right? I don't have this special revelation that he had. I'm not going to be writing scripture for you. But what I do have is that, like Paul, I became a servant of the gospel, and not based on my own strength. That was a gift from God to serve this gospel. And Paul, he says he was less than the least of the Lord's people. Well, I'm not as good as Paul. I'm sorry. You know, when Paul walked by, his handkerchief could heal people on the spot. Even his shadow had this healing power. Right? And I certainly don't deserve to be here on merit. I'm not the best speaker in the world. I'm not the best person in the world. I don't have the greatest past similar to Paul. But while I was a sinner, Jesus Christ died for me. And he worked in my life. He worked in my heart. He brought me to a point where I realized that I'm broken. And I realized that I'm poor. I have nothing. And I'm not talking about physically poor. I was poor in my heart. And then God revealed to me that, well, Christ is rich. Boundless riches. That, yes, we're all poor. We're all broken. But actually, Jesus Christ is rich. And that's all I can preach. The boundless riches of Jesus Christ. It's all about him. And that's my promise to you. If you vote yes today, that's all I can bring. I'm going to preach the boundless riches of Jesus Christ. Well, what are some of those riches? Even just looking through Ephesians, there's so many of them. In the very first chapter, Paul tells us, we have been redeemed. We've been bought with the blood of Jesus Christ. We have been saved. Our sins have been forgiven. We've been given the Holy Spirit, which not only brings gifts to us, but is also a seal, a guarantee that we are saved. That when Jesus comes back, we will be with him. We will be his people. That, you know, there will be a crown of glory in the final day. That we don't have to worry about eternity. Jesus Christ has taken care of our eternity. We just have to worry about today. We have to worry about our little slice of life. And honestly, that's just us. But if you think about Jesus, who is truly God, he is infinite. If I started today and I never stopped for my entire life, I would never be able to describe just how glorious he is, how beautiful he is, how wise and how powerful he is. That's what boundless riches means. There's no boundary. Right? You can keep going and you'll never get to the end of it. It is boundless. That is the God which I worship, the creator of the universe.
Amen.
Jesus Christ. And I don't have that special revelation Paul had, but I do have the scriptures, which Paul wrote down and God preserved for us, for the church, so that we can begin to understand this amazing event that happened on the cross, where Jesus Christ took the sins of the entire world on his back. And so that's the other promise I can make, that if you vote yes, I'll preach the boundless riches of Jesus, and it will always come from the scriptures. Mm-hmm. Because that's all I bring. You know, I can tell you my own testimony, and that's one thing, but at the end of the day, I'm only here because of the scriptures and because of the God they lead us to. For ages it was kept hidden, but it's not hidden anymore. It has been revealed to us. And we're thankful for that. Now hopefully that's enough about me. Alright? I've got a couple verses in there about myself. Now let's talk about you. The church. Remember what Catherine said first thing this morning? We're thankful that the church is not just the building, it's the people in the building. Right? So now it's time to talk about you. Let's go to verse 10 and 11. His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. Did you catch that, church? I'm going to read it one more time. His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. God uses the church to reveal his wisdom to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. That's the angels. Can you imagine that? God is using you right now to reveal his wisdom to the angels. And yeah, he could use other things, right? But he chose to use you. So Mark, when you're sitting there in the back and you're helping along with the tech stuff, that's God revealing his wisdom to the angels. And that should totally surprise us, because we know that all of creation is groaning. Paul tells us about that in Romans 8. Now, I don't have a slide for this, I'll just read it to you. Romans chapter 8, verses 19 to 22. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. All of creation is groaning because sin entered the world through Adam and Eve. And all of creation has been awaiting for the return of Jesus Christ. And think, the angels, they are part of the creation. They're not eternal. God created the angels. So just like us, they are awaiting for the return of Jesus Christ. And they know, like, they see God a lot more closely than we can see God most times. They know how glorious he is. They know how powerful he is. They know how magnificent he is. They know what it's like to be in heaven. And they know that something amazing is going to happen when Christ returns, when his plan is fulfilled. They know that God has this amazing plan to deal with sin and with death. And they know that creation is not what it should be. That this world needs a renewal. This world needs a revival. And God uses us. He uses you and me to show his wisdom to them. And you should know this, actually. And I know it's not a common truth, but actually Jesus talks about the angels rejoicing when a sinner repents. I'll read that passage for you. Luke 15. You probably know it, and I think this is why the angels are rejoicing. Chapter 15, starting in verse 3 of Luke. Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 people who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. That when we are down here, we're stumbling through life, but when we get it right, when we repent, when we come to Jesus, actually the angels are rejoicing over us. Because they are seeing God's wisdom, God's wonderful plan to save people, God's wonderful plan to bring them into communion with him. Forever in heaven. And so you sitting here, you being a part of God's church, you being a part of the body of Christ, that's not a small thing. Right? If you call yourself a Christian, you are used by God to show his wisdom. And that's amazing. But for some people, that can be a little scary, knowing that the angels are watching all the time, right? Because I know many of us, we don't feel very wise. And you might look at the church around you and say, "Okay, well, what's so special about this group of people? What is this group of people God's great plan?" Yes, it is. Yes, it is. This is God's great plan. This group of people sitting right before me, you are tied up in this eternal story, in this cosmic story about a battle between righteousness and sin, a battle between God and Satan, and we know that God wins. But you are part of his plan. So, how, you might ask, how do we as a church make God's wisdom known to the angels? And unfortunately, we can probably think of the negative examples before we think of the positive ones. So let's get those out of the way. Because I obviously don't the residential school system in the name of the church. I don't think the angels are rejoicing when they think about the Crusades and the Inquisition many years ago. I don't think the angels rejoice when someone comes and smiles and waves Sunday morning, but Friday night they have an affair. I don't think the angels rejoice when a church gossips and slanders and tears each other apart. And I don't think God's wisdom is revealed when Christians decide to hate somebody else based on the color of their skin. But on the contrary, there are ways that we, as a church, can reveal God's wisdom. And here's the trick to this. Is that it's not a different list than what you already probably know. It's not like you have to do something special to reveal God's will to the angels, to reveal God's wisdom to the angels. It's just the same things that you would do as a church, as a good Christian, in your normal walk with life. And you probably know these things, right? So when the angels see us conquer an addiction or a sin, when they see us rise above this filthy, sinful generation, when they see us standing for truth, standing for God's truth in a world that doesn't want to hear it, when they see us sharing the gospel with someone who desperately needs to hear the message of Jesus Christ, when they see us leading someone to repentance and accepting Jesus as their Lord and Savior, when they see us forgiving one another, loving one another, blessing one another, bearing with one another, confessing sins to one another, when they see us being at peace with one another, serving one another, when they see those things, they know that God is wise, that His plan is wise, and they praise God because of it. They give the glory to God. So because of what we do here and now, actually, God is being glorified in heaven. So your actions really matter. All of our actions matter. And we can glorify God through our lives. And that's one thing I think that gets missed a lot when we talk about the church. Actually, just this past week, Anna and I, we do a Wednesday Bible study with my church back home. And we were talking, we're on Zoom, we were talking about what's the point of the church meeting together, right? And we talked about lots of things, right? We gotta reach the lost. We gotta teach the found. We gotta get together and worship and praise our glorious God. We gotta pray for each other and uphold one another and help each other practice spiritual gifts. All these things. One thing we forgot is making the angels glorify God. Doesn't make it to the list very often. And like I said, it's not like it's a whole new thing. When we do all those other things, the angels see it, and they glorify God. They say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Blessed is the Lamb. He is worthy to open the seals." So I just want to quickly recap what we looked at today. So Paul has this revelation from God, from Jesus himself. The revelation is that Jesus died for the sake of everyone. Everyone sitting here. Jesus died for you. And because he preached that message, people got saved. But also because he preached that message, he ended up in prison. So that's our gospel foundation. Jesus died for everyone. And so I wanted to introduce you to myself as well. That was the second section, the preacher. Where I identify with Paul. And I make a promise to preach the boundless riches of Christ. And I make a promise to always preach them from the scripture. And thirdly, we looked at the church and God's amazing plan to reveal his wisdom through us. Now, before we move on to the last couple of verses, I just want to point out something on this slide. Look how the preacher and the church, that's two different lines, right? And there's this common misconception that the preacher is a church. Right? And so sometimes maybe you hear it. I know it, Pastor Renee back home, sometimes people come to him and say, well, you know, this church needs to do more of whatever. And what they really mean is, well, you as a pastor, you need to do more of whatever. Right? But I'm just one guy. And yes, I'll be a part of the church, but I'm not the church. You are the church. Right? And actually, I think that maybe that misconception comes from, say, the Roman Catholic Church, right? They teach that, well, once you put on the robes, now you're part of the church, right? You have to go, you have to be ordained and laid on hands and the oil and everything. That those people are the church, but everyone who goes to the church, well, you're just the unwashed masses or whatever. Well, as Baptists, we have a technical theological term for that kind of thinking. It's called baloney. Okay? And it's because everyone here is the church. And even if you go home, you're still the church there. So everything you do, the angels are watching. And the reason we call it baloney is because of what Paul says in the next verse. And we'll go to that final verse and wrap it up here. In him, and through faith in him, we, that's everybody, you sitting here, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are for your glory. And so there's only two questions that I have for you. If you want to know, are you the church? Are you in him? Are you in Jesus Christ? And secondly, do you have faith in him? Because if you do, if you answer yes to both those questions, if you say, yes, I'm in Jesus, yes, I have faith in him as my Lord and Savior, and you are the church. And you may approach God with freedom and with confidence. And that means you don't need to come to me. I'm not saying I don't want people to come to me. I love praying with people. I love to come alongside you and pray and then hear about the answered prayers. But my point is, I won't be with you on the day of judgment. You don't have to face God by yourself. But you know who will be with you? Jesus Christ. If you are in him, you have faith in him. And that's why Paul said, don't worry about my sufferings. Because I got Jesus and I'm okay. And I'd like to pray to close. And usually I would write my own prayer and pray through. But actually, Paul, in the next verse, he goes on to start a prayer. So I'm going to read his prayers. Before I do that, I want to read the next verse, because he finishes that sentence we started. He says, for this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. Now here's his prayer, so please join me in prayer. God, I pray that out of your glorious riches, you would strengthen these people with power through your Spirit in their inner beings, so that Christ may dwell in these people, in their hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and how long and how high and how deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, in him be glory to the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for listening. song, Adam. That's my favorite, too.